So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We'll begin this special session with Secretaries to the Government of India. May I invite Mr. Pankaj Patel to please escort our panel of Secretaries, Shri Ramesh, Abhishek, Secretary, Department of Industrial Promotion and Policy, Shri Subhash, Chandra, Garg, Secretary, Economic Affairs, Ministry of Finance, Shri Amit, Khare, Secretary, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, and Shri Anup, Wadhawan, the Commerce Secretary. We will soon be joined by Ms. Aruna Sundarajan, who is the Secretary, Department of Telecommunications. So to begin the session, may I request Mr. Pankaj Patel to present green certificates to our distinguished panelists. First, Mr. Ramesh Abhishek. Mr. Garg. Mr. Amit Khare. And Mr. Anup Wadhawan. May now request Mr. Pankaj Patel, immediate past president FICCI and chairman Cadila Healthcare, to moderate the session.
So very good afternoon. We are going to start this very important session for the theme New India. And I think we have people who actually going to make that happen in our country, because ultimately the political leadership will take some policy initiative, but actually making that happen is the panel of secretaries who are in front of us going to basically be responsible for making that happen. So it's a great pleasure to have some of our senior secretaries from Government of India among us today. Friends, Indian economy is at the crossroads. We saw yesterday in the AV that how and what opportunity India have and what kind of milestones we can achieve. We have the opportunity here. We all talk about the demographic strength India has, our strong GDP growth, our entrepreneurial and startup spirit, and of course, the knowledge of ability to of knowledge and soft power on technology. Also, very well of late, we've been doing extremely well in into other areas like sports, and I think it's, we clearly see there is a good opportunity. And I think, as we know, our challenges, which is around the job creation, removing the economic inequality, improve the education system in India, and of course, very importantly, providing a better healthcare for people. And I think in that, that's a dream of New India. And we have some, among us some of the people who are championing this cause. Friends, you know, over a period of last 4 years, we have seen a significant improvement in ease of doing business. And if one person who has to take full credit for that is none other than Mr. Ramesh Abhishek, who is a secretary DIPP, who have been championing this cause. And I've seen personally that the interest he has taken in making sure not only at the center level, but at the state level of creating awareness, creating a healthy competition among the state, and also coaching them to make sure that how we can improve our ease of doing business. And all of you are aware that we have achieved a significant a milestone of getting up to from a 100 plus rank to now 77th rank. And I'm sure, sir, your goal to achieve the to be among the 50 countries, I think is going to happen the way you have taken it forward. So we, I have pleasure in welcoming Mr. Ramesh Abhishek, and we are looking forward for his interaction. We have one secretary joining now with us, Srimati Aruna Sundarajan. She is Secretary telecommunication, and we're looking forward because I think communication, as we all know in the current era, communication is very important, and the way the new technology is taking us ahead, it is going to become a very important tool also as we grow forward in the growth of economy, and I think we will also look at hearing from her. We have Mr. Subhash Gargji with us. He's the Secretary Economic Affairs in Ministry of Finance. I think, sir, we have been interacting a lot on the global economy, and I think we look at how India would play its role in the global economy, because if world has to grow, India has to grow. And I think that is where, if the world is looking at India to grow, but that to happen, we would need significant things happening in our country. And under your leadership, I'm sure, some of the challenges we currently face, like the liquidity issue with particularly the MSME industry, is going to be, I think, you are looking at addressing, and we'd like to hear more from you. We have also with us Shri Amit Khareji. He's from the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. Communication again, and the digital world, it's going to be so important that digital communication is going to be very important going forward. Some of my colleagues from FICCI Presidium now don't read newspaper but look at iPads to read newspaper. It's clearly indicating the way people are moving forward towards using more digital technology into that. And sir, we'd like to hear from you how India will go ahead in the path of this digital communication going forward. I think when we move into this global era, I think global business is at challenging time. Countries are looking more inward than outward. In that scenario, India has still maintained to look at as a kind of a supporter of WTO and supporting the global trade. We have with us Mr. Anup Wadhawanji, who is the Secretary of Commerce, and we're looking forward to hear from him how India will path its growth ambition on global trade. I think one of the challenges we have seen over a period of time that our imports have grown faster than the exports, and we need to really see how we can increase our export equally fast. And I think Make in India and Make in India for India is going to be the cause, and how Commerce Ministry can look into that. So with these few words, I would look at listening to our learned panel here, how the India will take its path forward for the new India. So I would request Mr. Ramesh, Abhishek ji, to start with that, and then we will move forward with each of them. Later on, maybe we will raise some questions. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Pankaj bhai. Very good morning, and maybe it's afternoon now. You know, one of the critical things to be done for having a faster growth of the economy, much higher per capita income, and of course, gainful employment for our people, is improving the competitiveness of Indian businesses. Whether it's a question of getting a bigger share of world trade, exports, competing with the imports, there are many issues that need to be addressed, but main thing is competitiveness. So we are now coming out with an industrial policy which is under consideration of the government, that how to make our business enterprises not only competitive, but also prepare them for the future, because there are enormous opportunities which are coming up by way of Industry 4.0, new technologies like artificial intelligence, and we have a real opportunity to leapfrog into this new era of technological progress, though we may have missed some of the earlier technological upgradations. What the government has been doing in the last four and a half years is all a part of that story, I would think. You know, improving infrastructure. The cost of doing business is a very critical part of competitiveness. And logistics cost is one of the critical ones. So infrastructure development has been neglected by and large. But now, 4 years, there's a massive investment in infrastructure growth. I think that's very important. GST is another very game-changing reform that's going to make our industry businesses more competitive as we go along. Ease of doing business is definitely reducing the cost of doing business by reducing the time taken for approvals, by the cost, and making things simpler. And of course, skill development is another very critical area as we go forward. Skilling and reskilling will be a very, very critical component for income growth as we go along, if we have to take advantage also of the new opportunities in the era of Industry 4.0. We have to look at all these things in a cohesive manner, and I think one of the most important things in competitiveness is to improve our innovation ecosystem. We have to make sure that our public-funded research and development, our universities, our industry, our businesses work very closely together. Not only the funds, public funds which are is invested in R&D have a much better return, but they are demand-driven also, the needs of the businesses, industry and the society. Some very concrete steps are being taken today to establish this connect. I think we have to really work hard to improve our development of design and technology, and a lot of work is already being done. We also have to make some strategy of how to acquire technologies. Whatever we can't develop, how to acquire them abroad. I think this innovation is one of the most important parts. So we are all working in that direction. And through this policy, industrial policy, we are hoping that governments at all levels, state governments, local governments, and of course, central government departments, they will come on board how to make our businesses more competitive. Let's not do anything that will make them uncompetitive, because we have a very challenging environment in which many countries around the world are competing for investments. They are doing many right things. So gradually, we will be driven out of export markets. It will be more difficult to compete with imported products unless we consciously work on all these issues. Standards and quality is another one, which is extremely important. So I think we have to work on all these fronts. And we are definitely going to, once the industrial policy is approved, we have proposed a very robust framework for implementation of that policy. At that time, we would like to work very closely with business, industry, and industry associations, and all stakeholders, states. We all have to work as a Team India to make sure that this comes in the public discourse, that we have to grow our business enterprises, make them competitive so that they are part of the global value chains, regional value chains. There's no other option. So I think this is really important that this fact is highlighted, and whatever work we have done on ease of doing business and many other areas are all basically a part of the same story.
Thank you, sir. I think we would take up more with you, but I think it's heartening to learn that you're talking about competitiveness for the business. And I'm sure that the plans which government is thinking should actually help us to also improve our ranking on the global competitive index as well. With that, I would request now Shri Subhash Garji to also throw some light on New India Dream from an economic perspective of India.
Thank you, Patelji. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be with you all. I think when we conceptualize the idea of the New India, I think we need to keep into consideration a couple of major things which are happening. We have a huge backlog of growth and the poverty alleviation which we need to do it. But we also need to take into account what is happening globally and what major changes are taking place so that we can conceptualize and make our efforts and policies and programs towards creating that new India. In that respect, quite a few things attract my attention. One major change which is now taking place globally is this digital transformation which is happening. We had agriculture revolution, we had industrial revolution, and now we are in the midst of this massive digital revolution which is taking place. Sometimes when we are in the midst or at the commencement of the big revolutionary changes, we don't realize, we recognize it much later, but a major transformation is underway today. We here are in the business of producing goods and services, distributing them to the ultimate consumers, but that entire business of production of goods and services and its distribution to people is undergoing that massive transformation thanks to use of the digital technology. It's so massive that the production itself, we heard in the industrial revolution, is the scale of economy concentrated production, urbanization, all of that resulted because of the kind of imperative which was there in the industrial economy. But the digital technologies probably will allow a very different way of production and delivery of services. We are seeing the e-commerce, we are seeing now the production, even homes may become a major producing centers with robotics and 3D printing and all very decentralized. So I think this is one major change which we need to acknowledge and plan for going forward. An economy 20 to 25 years hence would be completely different than what it is. So this is one big change which we need to take into account. Second thing, which I, in my judgment, which is very much necessary for building this new India, is to take care of our infrastructure. We have done quite a lot in infrastructure improvements in road sector, ports, airports, and all, but still enormous infrastructure deficit exists in our country. And that is where more of the investment going forward is likely to come and should come, which would not only deliver services to people, but would also be the investment opportunity for the business. My sense is that in the investment in production of goods and services, otherwise in the conventional sense, possibly with production more or less now globally reaching to a scale where the demands of the consumers are met. So on conventional production, there may not be as much of the investment required as was the case a couple of years back. But for infrastructure, there is enormous and huge opportunity in infrastructure everywhere, whether you talk in terms of our cities, whether you talk in terms of decentralized delivery of services to everyone in rural areas and all. So that would be, to my mind, the second big change which we need to take into account and build our new economy. The third, to my mind, is we have so much or so many people still trapped in agriculture. Any economy where still 55 to 60% of the people are dependent on agriculture is not going to be a very large, very rich and prosperous economy. Globally now, most of the agriculture employs only about 5 to 6% of the people. There are very few, there are few economies where even less than 1% of the people produce all that agriculture product which is required for consumption. We have so many people trapped, and that's also the reason why we see so much of the poverty in rural areas. We will have to plan and see that the agriculture farmers and the laborers go out of agriculture and get transformed into the service economy and the manufacturing economy and the new digital economy. Very few, I don't think more than 10% of the people should remain in India in employed in agriculture and all. That big transformation, if we can enable by our policy and programs, that would also contribute, to my mind, going forward in building our new India. Next big thing, to my mind, is what we have created. To some extent, this is making all of us suffer, is this environmental degradation. So we have seen environmental degradations in cities, in rivers, in all areas, which is affecting our lives. Delhi today still having the particulate matters in unhealthy or that kind of zone for so much. It has happened globally where many countries have faced this kind of situation, but they have cleaned up. We can also clean up. We must also clean up. And this whole concept of the circular economy now, where you manage the production and consumption system in such a way that at the end of the day, there is nothing called waste into air or water or otherwise. We need to get that right also. If we can get that right, we will have healthier life, we will have richer lives, and we will have more wholesome life. So these are a couple of things which I see as the major changes which we need to take it into account. Otherwise, an economy or a new India would be built mostly on the back of very sound macroeconomic management. That is what we have tried to do in last few years in India. Our macroeconomic aspects are now considered to be the best managed globally, whether you look at the fiscal deficits or you look at the inflation management or the foreign reserves, etc. Fiscal deficit, we are very close to now coming to 3% level, which is considered to be reasonably ideal. We still have overhang of a very large debt, of public debt especially. Maybe in next 4 to 5 years, that's the area we'll need to focus. Most credit rating agencies and otherwise give a lot of weightage to the debt to GDP ratio of the country. We focused more on the fiscal deficit presently, but going forward, that is the area where we will need to focus. Inflation, I think we have more or less conquered, I wouldn't say. Things may not go wrong. It can go wrong sometimes. There are certain external factors like oil, etc., which are not completely in our control. But I think we are reasonably assured that the inflation, etc., is less of a worry going forward. So we can build the new economy, whether you talk about 25 or 22 or 2030. In different terms, sometimes we mentioned a $10 trillion economy by 2030 or a $5 trillion economy by 25. All these are feasible. I think we can achieve it if we pay attention to all these major trends and we are able to be, we are smart enough, we are adaptive enough, and we are intelligent enough to absorb those trends and then build our economy accordingly. I think future is bright. We can make it happen. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I think important thing we heard from Mr. Gadkari also in the morning about the infrastructure, and you also highlighted that there is a huge opportunity in infrastructure. We would take up that in the question answer more. I would now request Shri Amit Khareji to talk about it. Sir, India is economy-wise and sector-wise, Indian businesses are becoming global. This is one area where your media and communication area, where I believe that Indian players should also become a world economic power in the new India dream. And today, where we go out of India, we see either CNN, BBC giving news, and now, of course, some other regional players. How we can create policies by which India media houses become also the global player.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for inviting me here. It is a pleasure to interact with the captains of industry. We had a meeting about in October where members of the MND industry under the aegis of FICCI had an interaction with all the officials of the ministry. Now, coming to the MND industry, media and entertainment, broadly speaking, there are five significant features. First, it is a very high growth industry, particularly the film or the animation sector. It is showing a growth of more than 27%. So it is high growth. Second, which is more important than this growth, is the employment creation. You know, when I became secretary, many people congratulated me that it's a very glamorous type of a job. You know, IND deals with films and TV and all. But behind the actors or the serials or the films, there is an entire economy and the employment of those who are making the creatives, even the persons who are handling the light studios. There is a total number employed directly would be about 1 million. Plus, it is creating 1.5 lakh jobs every year. And there is also an estimate by various consultants that for every job which is directly created, there is a 3 times multiplier effect, in the sense if there is a film exhibited in a mall, other than the direct revenues, you know, there will be some, in the mall, there will be some food stall, there will be some other avenue where the people would be going. So it is creating about 1.5 lakh jobs per year directly, and there is also a multiplier effect of 2.9 to 3 times. Third, which is known to all of you, you also referred in your opening remarks, is the very rapid technological change. You know, the earlier the distinction that we used to have between the print media, the audiovisual, the broadcast, the telecom services, now they are all merging. And with these technological changes comes the fourth point, that the regulations have by and large not taken place at the same pace as the advances which are being made in technology. Without going into detail about these regulatory aspects, the consistent view of our ministry, as you may have seen in the last few months, has been that we are relying more on self-regulation than having an external monitor, given the fact that the Indian industry is mature enough to regulate itself. The fifth feature, which I keep emphasizing on the officials, not on those present here, but the officials within the ministry, that MND sector is totally private driven. Other than, say, Prasar Bharati, if you leave apart Prasar Bharati, which is supported by the ministry, 875 channels that we have, they are all private. If you leave the few films which are produced by NFDC, roughly 1900 films which are produced every year in the country, they are all private. All the exhibitors, the theaters, they are all private. So the role of the government, therefore, should be to facilitate, nurture, and protect the private sector. All three words are important. I am using the word protect in this sense. Piracy is a big issue as far as the films and entertainment is concerned. It requires, particularly now that we have reached a stage where we are a big creator of content, and Indian content is popular even outside the country. Latin American countries are actually on the same, I mean, their culture is almost same, so they are appreciating this content. So there is a great need to save the industry from the piracy. We are bringing certain provisions for stopping the camcording which happens within the theaters. That is one issue which was highlighted by the members in the last meeting. Otherwise, also at the international level, DIPP has taken the lead. We have requested them that signals should be protected. If the signals which are created by Indian content creators, if they get copied or stolen in some other country abroad and then sent back to either India or to a third country, that causes a great loss. I mean, the revenue loss is in hundreds of crores. So the protection in terms of prevention of piracy, facilitate capacity building. You know, unfortunately, training, and I'm glad that Mr. Shenoy had worked a lot for under NSDC. So we are having some arrangement to develop more skills in the sector. That is because 1.5 lakh jobs, but unfortunately, training facilities are not there. And third, in the new areas which are emerging, particularly gaming, animation, we are developing center of excellence because the investment required, initial investment required is very high, and that is where the private industry and the government can work together so that already many of the Hollywood films, the special effects that we witness in those films are actually developed in Hyderabad or Bangalore. So given this power that we have in software technology, this is another area, animation and gaming, where we can be a world leader. So the entire role of the government and the ministry in particular is to facilitate and also to protect from piracy the entire sector and to let the private sector grow, because the entire growth that we have seen in this sector has been led by the private sector. So the policies, I may also mention that although the DIPP, the FDI policy has allowed 100% FDI, there are certain lacuna in the sectoral policy which we are correcting. I won't go into much detail because we have to go before the cabinet. But we are trying to align our sectoral policies with the FDI policy of the government so that 100% FDI except in the news sector. And you would appreciate news as an item where there are certain sensitivities involved, and we cannot go for FDI more than 49%. But for the remaining sector, we are also opening to FDI as per the policy of the Department of Industrial Policy. And I'm sure with the cooperation that we have between industry and the government, there will be a good growth in this sector. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And I think we had a we would have more discussion on these great opportunity India have in the, your segment, sir. I would now come to Shri Anup Wadhawanji to talk about the current global scenario on the global trade and how what kind of things we can do and how can we envisage new India in the current global scenario.
Well, thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here, and my thanks to the organizers for making that possible. I think the previous speakers have covered a lot of ground on the broader economic situation, on the broader economic evolution, the broader economic aspirations that we have as a country. Let me give the external sector perspective to that. And let me just briefly explain the challenges the external sector has faced in recent times and where we stand today and where we hope to go in the future. As you all know, we were hit by the global financial crisis. In fact, the world was hit by the global financial crisis in 2008-09. It would have been better to term it as the developed country financial crisis, but the ramifications, because everything happened in the developed world, and in fact, the most developed part of the developed world, but the ramifications were, of course, global, so it became the global financial crisis. And you know, we withstood it very well. As far as the external sector is concerned, we withstood the initial shock very well. There was a marginal decline in our exports in 9-10, but then we recovered, you know, beautifully, and our exports peaked at about $314 billion in the year 13-14. Then the downturn accentuated. It hit the real economy in a big way. China got impacted for the first time. And then 13-14 onwards, we had 2 years of decline, 14-15, and 15-16 was a major sharp decline. But then since 15-16, thanks to various policies we put in place, various, you know, economy-wide initiatives that were launched by the government, 15-16 onwards, 16-17 onwards, we've had a 2.5 years of export growth. 16-17 was positive, 17-18 was positive, and 18-19, which is the current year, is even more positive in terms of export growth. The trade deficit also, I think trade deficit peaked for us at about $190 billion in, I think, 12-13, or somewhere around then. Since then, we've withstood that challenge quite well. Now again, because of various circumstances which are developing, oil prices have shown a increasing trend in recent times, which has moderated now. Export deficit, trade deficit, which went down significantly from the peak of $190 billion, went up a bit again last year to $160 billion. And this year again, there is some tendency of the export, the trade deficit being at a relatively high level. But as an economy, we have withstood that very well, thanks to, you know, services trade, thanks to remittances, thanks to strength on the capital account. Now there again, a recent challenge is the rising interest rates in the West. So the capital account has come under some challenge. The current account used to be the trade account used to be under pressure, which was compensated by the services surplus, compensated by remittances and the healthy capital account. So there's a temporary phenomena where the capital account is also under pressure. So the rupee has been under pressure, as you know, because of this, you know, double aspect of the global stress which is there on the external sector. The environment remains challenging even beyond the issue of oil prices. in terms of, you know, protectionism across the world, unilateralism across the world. We've seen, you know, trade wars of various hues being fought out, and some sort of estimation is being made that the world might be heading for a slight recessionary phase. So that is a major challenge that India needs to, you know, take into account and address. The entire state of play at the WTO is influenced by all these tendencies towards unilateralism, protectionism, and the environment at the WTO remains a bit uncertain. However, we are engaged with various nations to see that the robust multilateral rule-based system, which has served us well by way of the WTO, that remains strong, and remain the dispute resolution system, which is again its future is in a bit of doubt, remains intact, and the effort to balance the ambitions of countries with the developmental sensitivities of countries, that ambition is fulfilled through the WTO platform. Because as you know, the world comprises of a diverse number of countries, you know, ranging from countries at $60,000 per capita income to countries like India at about $2,000 per capita income, and their ambitions and sensitivities will necessarily be diverse. And WTO was a good platform where these diverse ambitions and diverse sensitivities could be well balanced. So we'll continue to pursue that effort. At a broader level, as far as our external sector goes, we face certain challenges which we need to address. I think our export sector is, you know, way below potential in terms of its size and sophistication. We need to realize that potential. If you compare with a country like Vietnam, their exports are in the order of about 300 billion, and that is where we are today. So that in a sense reflects what is the gap between the potential we can achieve. And I think with the sort of efforts which are happening over the last 3-4 years, which Secretary DIPP has highlighted, with those efforts, I think this potential will be achieved. The other aspect is the level of sophistication of our exports. I think in our exports, traditional commodities still have a very high weightage. And as you know, our traditional commodities are very recession prone. If you look at, you know, gems and jewelry, you look at leather goods, all these are very recession prone items. They're in a sense in the luxury category, and they involve expenditures which are dispensed with in a recession. And there is increasingly a sophisticated component in our exports, engineering products, but there again, I think there is scope for raising the level of sophistication. Electronics is a growing strength, but then we are highly dependent on imported inputs, so we will need to address that. And we have, as a result of issues which were mentioned by Secretary DA, issues related to economic transformation, where we need to grow the secondary and tertiary sectors, where the agriculture sector needs to shrink. For the lack of diversity caused by that, relatively slow transformation, if you look at our history of economic development. So lack of a diversified production base impacts exports also. So the entire issue of having a sophisticated component in our exports will depend on how quickly we are able to transform our economy. Even the dependence on imports, we are dependent on, apart from petroleum, where we can't do much about it, of course, other than promoting non-conventional sources, which we are doing. Even other areas, we have an unnaturally high dependence on certain inputs, which will also be addressed if that kind of economic transformation happens, which Secretary DA was mentioning, and we grow our secondary and tertiary sectors. You see, So essentially, the performance of the external sector will depend on how effectively we put in place and implement and make effective all our plans for having a regulatory and policy environment that is investor friendly, for having good infrastructure, for creating a low cost economy where our businesses are competitive. And I think on the sort of regulatory and policy side, we made huge leaps in the last few years. Most of our approval processes are highly streamlined. Most of our approval processes are digitized. And I think the ease of doing business rankings reflect that issue. Along with that, we have ongoing efforts to improve the state of infrastructure, to improve the physical environment of investment. I think physical environment of investment needs focus. The issues of land, labor, water, power, rail, road, ports. So I think that our ongoing efforts need to fructify and lead to the logical outcomes that we are targeting. And so essentially, I think ultimately, it will all depend on the kind of environment we are able to create for investment and entrepreneurship. A good investment environment, a good environment for entrepreneurship will lead to a thriving economy, it will lead to a growing manufacturing sector, a growing industrial sector, it will improve our capacity to export, it will reduce our unnatural dependence on imports of certain items. And I'm not talking about an autarkic kind of situation or a mercantilist kind of situation where we are somehow favoring exports and not favoring imports. In a present day globalized world, you necessarily have to import various inputs for domestic production, for exports. No country can make everything that it needs. So certainly, in a globalized economy, imports will remain important, but what I'm talking about is an unnaturally excessive dependence on imports, which I think will automatically come down once all these envisaged plans to diversify the economy, to grow the industrial sector come into place. And with all these efforts, my vision for India's future is in terms of thriving entrepreneurship. I think we are the best entrepreneurs in the world. If you look at the way Indians perform globally, the way Indians perform in spite of numerous challenges we face, we are perhaps the best entrepreneurs in the world. And if we are able to create the right environment for our entrepreneurs to flourish, for our entrepreneurs to invest confidently in this country and make it grow, then I see a very, very bright future for India, and I'm sure we are on that path. If you see the sum total of all the efforts which we are undertaking, which my colleagues have mentioned, we are on that path. And in that sense, the answers to how we can achieve our potential, the answers lie more in the audience. You're all entrepreneurs. You have to answer the question, what will it take? We are, of course, implementing policies, regulatory frameworks, of course, in consultation with everyone to the best of our ability and in good faith. But I think the most important element today is feedback from you. You are the entrepreneurs. What will it take for you to find our environment conducive for you to thrive? If you thrive, then India thrives. And I think I'll conclude with that, and I look forward in the interactions to getting some of those answers as to what we need to make you all thrive. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think I'll take the clue from you, and for want of time, I'll ask a question. Any one of you can pick up this question. So I think the first thing which I want to raise it, it's music to our ear that we're talking about creating an environment where entrepreneurs are encouraged to invest more and do more, and I'm sure all the audience here is actually eagerly looking forward. See, one of the challenges we face in our country is our regulatory mechanism. Our regulators believe something that they are only here to regulate. Now, as I understand, to my little bit of English knowledge, is regulation means you can increase or decrease. You just don't say you can just either increase or reduce. Our regulators look at one side. Growth is important. At the same time, certain adherence to certain things, which is national requirement, is important. But give an example. Just give you an example. In you know, the telecommunication sector is in distress. Now the telecommunication sector, the regulator says that it requires some support. The department feels, no, they don't need it. Now that's the challenge. I can give an opposite example, where department says a sector needs the support, the regulator talks other way around. How can the government agencies work in unison? We've seen recently about the liquidity crisis, also the same thing. So my point is that what kind of mechanism we can think by which everybody who is implementing these things, how can they work towards the dream of New India? Anybody can answer.
Let me attempt this. I think it's very important that all the public agencies, governments, departments, regulators, they work together to find solutions of any problem or any target or any thing that we want to achieve. This is very important. Because unless we have very specific targets and how to achieve, I mean, we will not get there. I'll give an example of the ease of doing business index of World Bank. See, our Prime Minister gave us a target that we should aim at reaching top 50. When he said it 4 years back, it was a very daunting target, which many people thought may not be possible. But by concentrating all the efforts of all the departments, by the states, two states in this case, and by the bureaucracy and the private sector working very closely together. And I must tell you that this partnership of with private sector, with the respondents, with the users have been extremely critical. We have all worked together to achieve this. So I think it's important that we all have very ambitious targets, which look impossible, but which can be achieved by working together. We must have this mindset. Three and a half years back, we did not have any proper investment promotion agency in Government of India. You know, Invest India was incorporated, but it wasn't doing much. We have built up this agency in a short span of 3 years. Today, they are facilitating more than $100 billion of FDI in the country. And they are active 500 facilitation cases. With their efforts, more than $10 billion have come. Today, they are working with the states to build up their investment promotion agencies in every state. It's an excellent project. They're building capacities on startups. We involved all the states. So we are all working together. I have worked as a financial sector regulator myself for 5 years before I came here. We used to talk to our stakeholders because we had a target that we have to deepen our markets. In this case, this was a commodity futures market. For how to connect this better with the physical market. So we worked very hard. And so I think it's important that people work together and find solutions. On 7th December, we had a venture fund global round table in Goa. And we had a session of regulators. And you know, we had drug regulator. We had a joint secretary of civil aviation. Joint secretary of civil aviation shared with the audience of 100 plus venture funds, 30 of them came from abroad, about the importance of drones in the future economy, what is the potential of the drone sector, and how the drone regulations have been made by the civil aviation, which are among the most progressive in the world. I asked the audience that, you know, if you don't know who that person is who is speaking, would you believe that she is a regulator in the government for drones? Because this is the positive mindset we need. We have drug regulator now working on very progressive regulations on a number of areas. I think this alignment to ultimate objective is very important for everyone, whether they are governments or regulators, because no one is working in isolation. We all have to work together, and finding solution is not so difficult. I've given some examples, and working with the private sector is very extremely important. Sometimes, what are the things to be done, we find out from the private sector. What are the best practices of other countries, we find out from you. So I think here businesses also have an important role in identifying what are the good practices in the world, what are the competitive issues that are coming up in respect of other countries, and give such a logic and fact data driven proposal and to the government and the regulators that it looks almost that you have to do this, otherwise there is no other choice. Whenever we are not aligned to the object, we are not accountable for results. Whenever we are not aligned to the ultimate objective of doing something on the ground, then we can behave any way we want. So I think this alignment with and accountability is very important for every public functionary, wherever they might be.
Let me just add to what Secretary DIPP, certainly you see, one major task of a regulator, ironically, might be to deregulate. And, you know, through creating competition. And I think in India, the path we've chosen emphasized a minimalist approach to regulation based on identifying what are your minimal key regulatory concerns. A regulator should bother about a minimal set of key regulatory concerns, address them in a minimalist fashion, ideally through deregulation, creating competition, and the tools regulators use should be, you know, non-intrusive. They should not involve too much micromanaging. So broadly, I think those principles, if you see the evolution of the regulatory sector in India, I think started off with the power sector in the 90s. Broadly, those principles have been kept in mind, and we need to retain focus on them. And I see the main task of the regulator as deregulation rather than, you know, getting into very intrusive regulation. And by and large, I think the Indian example sort of demonstrates that. Thank you.
So, sir, another question I have, and then we'll ask audience to take up a few questions. I think if you see, you gave an example that Vietnam has exports which is similar to size of India export is, I think one of the things which we can learn from what Chinese did is that they selected few sectors, focused it on it to build up the export economy. For example, and I'm just giving you one example, how they did things for even a small sector. Lighter, which cost a dollar or less. The lighter industry is the biggest industry for in China. The world lighter supply is only happening from China. How did they achieve? They created a lighter exhibition every year. They open lighter trade center in USA. They invited all the people who buy lighters to exhibition, paid them to come to China, stay there for 3 days and attend the exhibition. 5,000 people exhibited lighters in that. People came and said, no, I want this type and that type. 3 years they consecutively did it. They are now exporting $1 billion worth of lighters. Small commodity. Let's take. China has developed like that many sectors. India has the biggest advantage. Our film industry is so big that we can become the world content provider for media and film. There are so many such things can be done. If we want to build new India, we need to really select sectors. We cannot say, okay, software is, we are the leaders, good, excellent. But we cannot achieve the goal of becoming a global trade player without getting into more selected segment. Collective with that, one of the things which we also look at it, because the multilateral trade, WTO is under danger, bilateral trade things are happening, the FTAs which we have created or we are creating, we need to ensure that while we open our market to the people, they also open market for us. So our FTA with the country could be for several reasons, but one of the very important reasons is that how do we increase the bilateral trade? If we don't do this, it's going to be very challenging for us to really become a globally relevant player. So I think these are some ideas I have. Maybe you have a better idea, but if we want to build new India, we need to create sector-specific competitiveness, sector-specific growth, and then we can make that happen. And then through that, our new India dream can happen.
Yeah. I think
so.
I
will allow the audience to ask the question.
I'll just make a brief intervention. That I think you have already shared your idea with DIPP, because the champion sector that, sir, you have been promoting, and film is a part of the champion sector.
Right.
So we are both on the same page as far as developing some of the select industry as champion sector.
So I will ask, Mr. Ketan.
Let me just respond to your
yeah.
FTA related issues and all. You see, the broad take from what you're saying is that we cannot do meaningful reform on an economy-wide basis. You have to pick some instruments and do your reform. So, like, we need to transform our environment for investment, our physical environment for investment, and that cannot happen on an economy-wide basis. And I think initiatives like the SCZ initiative, the investment and manufacturing zones, which DIPP is promoting, those instruments are land-based instruments where we can create a state-of-the-art infrastructure on global standards. We can create a state-of-the-art regulatory environment through institutions like the Development Commissioner. To the extent the SCZ model needs reform, the government is working on that. So certainly, the take from what you're saying is that we need to create islands of excellence which become attractive for investors, and we are able to attract investors. But otherwise, picking winners and losers, like picking an industry which can win or picking an industry which can lose, if you look at the history of that in countries which have done it, it has not worked very well. Countries with governments, industries which governments picked as winners ended up to be losers, and the market had a logic of its own and threw up winners. So, but I agree with your point that we need some very specific pointed efforts on FTAs. FTAs, if you look at all our FTAs, we have asymmetric access. We have more access in those countries than they have with us. There again, the entire issue of being able to create the domestic environment to take advantage of it. The access is there, potential access is there, but to the extent we've not been able to take advantage of it, we have to understand why. We have a huge deficit with China, as you know, and you also know we have no FTA with China. So FTA is not the issue. The issue is how do you make yourself competitive, what Secretary DIPP mentioned. And if you're competitive, then the same FTA will have an entirely different, impact. So that's the thing to do.
Mr. Ketan.
There was a cover article in India Today. It was with caption Babudam. And I didn't know that. He said in 1947, when we got independence, there was a move to do away with civil service servants. And it was Sardar Patel who prevailed over it and said, no, the country will have a doomsday unless the administration is not in the hands of civil servants. Sir, we do recognize your contribution. But sir, the only issue which that particular article raised was the delay in decision-making process. And it was on two issues. One was a case of revolving files, and another was a scare today in the minds of civil servants. Sir, anyone can...
Towards me, so let me respond. See, no country can run the administration or even progress on economy or anything without a civil service. America today has 10 times more per capita civil servants than us. So civil servants will always be there. What probably that 1949 article refers is the civil service organized into different services, Indian Administrative Service or otherwise. So there are different methods of organizing services, but without civil servants, it's impossible. No government, no institutions, no organization, even your own organizations cannot function without the support and the staff. It's an impossibility. So we can organize it differently, but the civil servants would be needed to deliver.
Yeah, please.
My question is addressed to Mr. Wadhawan. I am from L&T manufacturing sector. China, the example what you gave, actually, it's not that there is no competitiveness. L&T especially has been exporting to China. One third of our export was to China. It was actually blocked by China by forming National Development Reforms Commission. So really speaking, whereas we are giving access of Indian market, which is a large market, to China, but the Indian manufacturers do not have the access to China. The FTAs, what you said, what we find is there is very limited market available in the countries with which we are signing FTAs, like Korea. In fact, there is a case where the Indian company is one of the three companies qualified in world, and there is a requirement for special equipment capital goods in Korea. We referred this case to government. Even the inquiry is not given to the Indian company. So unless the Indian government supports Indian capital goods manufacturer, I don't think our export will improve.
Anup, before you come in, can I just comment? Sure. See, we issued this Make in India in public procurement order last year in June. This addresses partly what you have said. There's a specific provision there that if any foreign country, they discriminate against Indian companies or Indian manufacturers, then the concerned ministry here in Government of India can also take reciprocal measures. We have got some complaints from maybe two or three companies that there is some discrimination in that country. We have asked them to give us evidence that please tell us what are these documents or practices, because there has to be some proof somewhere that there has been a discrimination against Indian companies. We have not been given any. L&T, we request you to give us not only the complaint, but also the evidence how it was discriminated. There is a provision, and we will ask the concerned ministry to take reciprocal measures. I can also add here that, see, we make policies and we are very keen to implement it, but we also need some communication and some evidence from the private sector. Please do that. We have been publicizing it so many times, and luckily, now we are getting more than 100 complaints today about discrimination against Indian manufacturers in procurement within the country. We have been, by taking proactive measures, we have been able to cancel more than 15,000 crores of tenders with various government authorities and public sector in last 1 year. Today, we have got large number of cases where domestic value addition has been mandated by various ministries and departments and are being implemented. But no discrimination is going to be allowed within the country in procurements. Please tell us. And now we have very large number of cases where we are taking effective steps. And on this issue, I invite anyone who has faced discrimination in any foreign country to let us know and give us the evidence. We will take reciprocal measures, I can assure you.
Good. Yes, sir, just to add to that, certainly, you see, there are non-tariff barriers which countries impose, and L&T might be facing some such non-tariff barriers. L&T is competitive, and that is why L&T is succeeding. I cannot dispute that. But that does not make us competitive on an economy-wide basis. So what you're saying is very consistent with what I'm saying. The fact that L&T is competitive does not mean that our economy on the average is at the global level of competitiveness. And as Secretary DIPP mentioned, if you're facing some non-tariff barriers, facing some illegal barriers which need to be taken up, then certainly let us know. We'll pursue those.
So we'll take the last question, yes.
Sir, last month FICCI did a seminar on fake, duplicate, spurious products, and it was reported in rural area, 58% all the products are fake, duplicate and spurious, and the lower regulatory, who should regulate them, instead of regulating, they are partners with such people and promoting. For example, agrochemicals or pharma, there are 30 to 40% products are spurious, and number of times.
I'm sorry. I don't think the data you are saying is right. These are not FICCI data. So I'm sure.
No,
I'm sure.
FICCI got survey from TSMG, and it is there. 35% agrochemicals are spurious.
Yeah, but that's not true for pharma.
Pharma, I can't say, but for agrochemicals.
You are generalizing. That's why I'm coming from pharma sector. I must correct you. That's not correct.
FICCI did. TSMG people are sitting with us. They did this survey before 3 years, and as per their survey in agrochemicals, 35% are spurious. And in spite of so many representation, no action has been taken, and rather this industry is flourishing and a big threat to genuine industry and our agriculture production.
I think that's a general problem, not for the New India. We could take up later on. So I think before I end, I have one request and a question for all of you to say. I would like you to say one thing which FICCI or the members sitting here should do for New India. With your ministry. one thing as FICCI or members should do for building the new India? Because we have been asking you, now we are asking you, telling you that tell us what we should do.
I know traditionally there has been a lot of trust deficit between the governments and citizens and also businesses in general. What we have been trying now is to bridge that deficit. Generally, I think there is much better awareness required among the government agencies and regulators about the challenges and the problems of businesses. So while the public authorities need to closely work with businesses, I think businesses also represented by CII, FICCI and you know other industry organizations, MSMEs, they need to work very closely with the government and regulators. And I was suggesting this to a group of business people a few days back. When you give them your requirements or demands or point out problems, some research is required to be done. See, there is some law or regulation is there for some or other reason. If you are saying that it should not be there, you have to give reasons, very cogent reasons in terms of what are the public interests that are getting affected by it. It will also help if you also point out what are the global best practices in that area. So you have to give a very cogent kind of paper or argument to people that you need to change this or you should not do this, because you have to look at it from their point of view. What I have found in my experience, and I have worked extremely closely with everybody, FICCI included, and we are genuinely like to create a business-friendly environment in the country, but that kind of research, that kind of effort is sometimes missing. I think we need to do that. Basically, what happens is that people write letters, don't get a reply most of the time, and they perpetuate their earlier feeling that nothing is going to happen anyway, that people are not sensitive. But are you doing your own homework? Are you persisting with it? You have to do that. So I think let's look at, empathize with each other. We businesses should look at the government point of view. Government should look at business point of view. And I think that is where the meeting of minds will take place. And that is where I think FICCI can play a much greater role.
I think my ask is very simple. Recognize the transformation. Look beyond the past. And invest in future. The future investment is in digital economy, infrastructure, environment, and transformation away from agriculture. If the industry can invest in these, it will contribute to the new India of our dreams. Thank you.
For MND sector, I have, unlike my senior predecessors, very specific two requests. One is gaming and animation is growing at a very fast rate. There are great opportunities there all over the world. We are already developing a center of excellence. FICCI is supporting us. And this would be one area where if we take the initial lead, we will be the world leaders. So I think this is, apart from the content that we have on TV and films, animation and gaming will be a very important sector, and particularly with this OTT platform, it will be, you know, we'll be a leader all over the world.
Mr. Wadhawan,
I think I had already anticipated the question and answered it, so I'll just reiterate that I would like you to work as a group to create an ecosystem for entrepreneurship to succeed. And let us know what we can do to help you succeed. So that's it.
Thank you very much. I think we had a wonderful session. A lot of new ideas and thoughts. You might have opportunity to meet them in person in future. All the secretaries who have been responsible for creating the dream of New India becoming reality. I want to thank each one of them to be with us this afternoon, to spend time with us and actually very candidly share their thoughts. Thank you very much, and let's give them a big round of applause.
So lunch is in the dining room downstairs. Please do join.